Good evening and welcome to Gibson's Bookstore Remote. I am Elizabeth, the events coordinator for Gibson's Bookstore, and I am here this evening with Dr. James Hollis, who is joining us this evening. Thank you for joining us this evening, sir.
Thank you, Elizabeth. Pleasure to be with you.
So this evening, we are pleased to have him with us while he presents his new work, Living Between Worlds, Finding Resilience in Changing Times. This book is available for purchase from Gibson's Bookstore, and we have signed book plates coming in the mail that we can include with any purchase from Gibson's Bookstore. Thank you for joining us. Tell us a bit about your book.
Well, I'm happy to. You know, the poet Archibald MacLeish said once, books are report on the mystery of things. And so this is my report on issues of how we survive during times of change. What provides us with a sense of continuity, or gives us a sense of purpose, or how do we retain a personal sense of dignity in the face of changes outside of us? I think, for example, we're going through a time now none of us would imagine a year ago, which I believe is the first time since World War II in which this entire country has been wholly engaged. By that I mean there are other national events, as we all know, the Challenger disaster, the 9/11, those sorts of things. But this has reached into everybody's personal life. It's reached into their threats to their own well-being. It's taken away their usual places of investment of their time and energy and so forth. And so it's caused many folks to have to fall back upon themselves. And so part of what this book is about is what happens when we don't find the support in the outer world that we are accustomed to. And many folks have realized inadvertently that they were far more dependent on their work schedule, their families, their social structures, their amusements, their entertainments, sports, and so forth, than they had ever imagined. And as a result, they've had a kind of inversion of energy, ranging from anxiety to depression to all kinds of efforts to sort of pass time and kill time and so forth and so on. But the real question then is what helps us through these times? I've been interested in that subject for a very long time ago because, you know, the nature of nature has changed. The nature of the human psyche is changed. And all of our ancestors have gone through periods of profound change. And what gave them a sense of ballast and a sense of direction and purpose? And how do we find ourselves at this time in a way in which we're capable of living this journey? Now, there's amazing timeliness to this book for the simple reason that when I started it 2 years ago and actually finished it over a year ago, I wasn't anticipating the virus to come toward us. But as I said, change is always with us. Change is thrust upon us from one way or another, and people experience loss, disorientation. I see typically 8 hours of clients per day as a functioning psychoanalyst. And most of them describe their experience as a kind of general malaise, a sense of being disoriented in time and space and adrift in some way. And so part of what I try to explain in this book in a non-technical way, I think in a way that's accessible to people, is how depth psychology can help people during these times. Depth psychology is really an invitation for us to engage in a conversation with our own inner life. I have a colleague in Minneapolis who said at the beginning of our sequestering, you know, many people in America, an extroverted country, are now being obliged to take on a kind of relationship to themselves. And I pointed out, and a lot of those folks will not enjoy the company that they find themselves in. So I think what we see in this engagement is an invitation to a deepened conversation around the meaning and the purpose of our lives. Now, we all think about psychology today in terms of changing our behaviors, and you know, it involves that. Maybe changing some of our thought process, and it can involve that, or maybe a magic pill that takes one's distress away. But depth psychology is an effort to engage a conversation with the unconscious, which when you think about it is extraordinarily difficult to do, because the unconscious is unconscious. We don't know what it's about. at the same time, we realize that what is going on inside of us, each of us, is spilling into the world on a daily basis. It affects our children, our partners, our neighbors, and most of all, ourselves as well. So then we have to ask ourselves, well, how do I begin to pay attention to what's going on inside of me? And one of the first places to look, of course, is the patterns that we have created in our lives. Begin to notice those patterns that you particularly find troubling, counterproductive, maybe digging the hole deeper, perhaps hurtful to you or to others. And we don't rise in the morning and look in the mirror while we're brushing our teeth and say, well, today you're going to do the same stupid, counterproductive things you've done for a very long time. But there's a good chance that we will. And why do we do these things? Well, our behaviors are always logical if we understand the emotional premise they're coming from inside of us. And that emotional premise may be wholly inaccurate as a reading of the world, or that emotional premise may have had its genesis long ago and far away, but there it is, operating unconsciously, unchallenged. So we take those patterns and we start working backwards. And we try to see, all right, from whence could these things have come? And sort of to challenge them. We've all heard the word complex, for example. We all have complexes because we have history. A complex is a neutral word, like apartment complex, airport complex. It's simply a structure that's charged with energy. It affects our body. We usually feel it in one way or the other. And it's attached to a story of some kind or a splinter narrative. And when that is activated, that has the power to rise up and take over our ego consciousness and enact its program. I mean, how many times have people stopped and said, gee, I wonder why I got so upset about that yesterday? Or they wondered why they wanted to say something at a particular meeting and they couldn't, they were frozen in some way. Or folk wisdom has long recognized, well, count 30 before you say something. Well, 30 is not enough, maybe 30,000. Or write the letter, but don't send it for 2 or 3 days. And then you approach the letter again, you realize, well, I don't quite feel that way today. Now, what is that about except folk wisdom acknowledging that there are clusters of energy in all of us that are charged clusters of our history? And when triggered from the outside, or sometimes they have their own spontaneous generation, they can essentially become search engines, if you will, and they are governing agencies within our psyche. So part of what we try to do in depth psychology is start paying attention in a different way. That's what the word therapy means from the Greek, to listen to or pay attention to. So we start paying attention to what? To the psyche. And what's the psyche? That's the word that in the Greek means literally soul, or our essential purpose, or our essential essence, if you will. So psychotherapy means literally paying attention to your own soul. And I want to sort of demystify psychotherapy. This doesn't have to be with a therapist. This is a process that you can engage in yourself. And then you start paying attention to certain elemental clues that we all have that are giving us some kind of instruction or some kind of intimation as to how our own psyche might want things. Problem with all of us, myself included, is we think that what we think is the extent of our reality. I think I know enough to make proper choices. But then again, all we have to do is look at our history and see the things that we regret along the way. And you realize, okay, there are other places inside of me from which some of those choices and their consequences are flowing. So we have to start then paying attention to what is the voice of the soul and how does it manifest? And these are elemental systems that we all have. And I talk about them in the book. Elemental systems we've had since childhood, but we've learned to override. One, for example, is the feeling function. the feeling function that we all know about, but we've learned to stuff our feelings. We've learned to rationalize them. We've learned to distract them. We've learned to medicate them. And if you really stop and pay attention and sort and sift and sort and sift through feelings, you begin to realize that there's some autonomous source within, wisdom, personhood even, inside of each of us that is making a qualitative analysis of how things are going. So let's say I've agreed to a whole rash of things that I'm wanting to do or I'm expected to do. And yet, having done them, I find that there's no satisfaction there. Or I've achieved the goals that I wanted to achieve in my life. And yet I find there's nothing there that's fulfilling. And you realize then that feeling function has been, you know, registering its opinion for a long time, but we've overridden it. And that feeling function is a qualitative analysis of how things are going from its perspective, from the perspective of the psyche, not from the perspective of the ego or the voices of the outer world that are constantly telling us who we are and what we're supposed to be doing. Another source of information that we've learned to override are energy systems. We can mobilize our energy to serve important tasks, and that's essential. That's how we survive, and that's how we're productive. We get up at 3 a.m. to feed the baby who's hungry and so forth. But we all know that if you keep expending your energy in a direction that is wrong for you, it leads to boredom, exhaustion, burnout, depression, self-medication, and so forth. And thirdly, we all have dreams. If you live to be 80 years old, as I am today, you will have spent 6 entire years of your life dreaming. That's extraordinary. Nature doesn't waste energy. It's serving a purpose somehow. It's commenting on our lives. And I know you're going to say, well, I don't dream or I don't remember my dreams, but we all do. Sleep research has indicated that we average 6 dreams per night. That's 42 a week. That's a lot of activity. And no one remembers all of those. But as we start looking at these productions that go on every night, you know, our own internal casting system, our own internal directors and producers and actors and actresses, we realize there's an extraordinary drama going on every night within us. And there's some reason to believe that even if we don't pay attention to our dreams, it's part of how our system metabolizes the magnitude of traumata that come to us on a daily basis. You know, we're bombarded with stimuli of all kinds, and nature sort of takes us to shut us down to process that. It's called sleep. But the sleep is not, you know, comatose. There's activity going on. And secondly, we begin to realize that the response of the psyche begins to show up in ways that comment upon a person's life. If I had time on another occasion, I could, from memory, recite dozens and dozens of dreams from people, and my own dreams as well, that were profoundly challenging to them, illustrative of some important issue for them, and literally helped them change their lives and move in new directions. And fourthly is the question of meaning. Meaning is the most elusive thing of all. As Carl Jung said once, the smallest of things with meaning is always greater than the largest things without meaning. And so we can do all the right things that we're supposed to do in our journeys. You know, marry this person, achieve this career, produce 2.5 children, et cetera, espouse certain values. And something inside is hollow. Something inside does not cooperate, or something that was meaningful at some point is literally outlived. And we begin to realize, okay, the psyche itself has moved on. That's one of those intrapsychic changes that has occurred in all of us. Now, this is essentially a way of trying to say all of us, and it's exacerbated by our social isolation at this point, all of us are invited to a deepened conversation around our own soul's journey. Now, you might think, well, that's self-indulgent, that's narcissism. It's not at all. Because you will find that kind of conversation ultimately humbling. Because you're going to find over and over and over, there are things about yourself you didn't know. There are things about yourself you didn't want to know, perhaps. You begin to understand where certain of those patterns come from. You begin to realize how much of our lives are driven, for example, by fear management systems. The human psyche seems to have two basic purposes. One is self-healing, and second is its continued growth and development. And that's profound, because that's the wisdom of nature expressing itself. I, as a psychoanalyst, don't heal anybody. I try to promote the conditions in which the self-healing can occur. And it's also true, paradoxically, and this may be very surprising to you, the first thing that occurs to us when we feel bad is, well, how quickly do I get rid of this? From a depth psychology perspective, we rather ask the question, why has this come to me? What does this mean? We don't suppress psychopathology. We interrogate it. We question it. Stop, remember what those words mean. Psyche, soul. Pathos, Greek for suffering. Logos, expression. So psychopathology that would be so easily, theoretically, changed by a behavior or medicated may very well mask or camouflage what is in fact most important for a person to discern, and that is, what is my own soul saying to me about how my life is being conducted? And psychopathology then literally means the expression of the suffering of the soul. That puts a whole different spin on it. The problem we're dealing with in American culture today is not itself new. As far back as the 17th century, the famous French mathematician, inventor, mystic Blaise Pascal noted in his Pensées, he said, all of our troubles stem from one source, the difficulty of being able to be with ourselves in our private chamber. Now, a lot of people have run into that difficulty recently, as we all know. And he noted how the court, he said, with all of the privileges of the court, and even the king will grow miserable indeed if they reflect upon themselves. He said, and therefore, we have invented the jester to distract the king. Now, the jest and the word for that distraction was divertissement, from which we get the word diversion. Popular culture is predominantly a form of diversion. We might be served well to ask the question, and what am I diverting myself from? What is it that is so troubling to me? What is it that is so threatening to me that I don't wish to address it in my own life? And obviously that's a technique and that we've all used at some point, but the issues never go away. They just begin to develop into new avenues in our lives. And so the gift of popular culture is essentially distraction. And then you have to ask yourself, all right, what is it I'm distracting from? What is my own soul calling me to? Now, I don't want you to think that this is somehow some kind of otherworldly preoccupation. All of this is ultimately about, how do I live my life in a concrete way? By what values do I live my life? And part of what I try to ask in this book are certain very pointed questions. Are you really living your life? We're living our lives. We're living in response to all kinds of stimuli and programs and admonitions and expectations and so forth. But we want to ask one more question, and what does your psyche have to say about that? And again, it's not the first thing that would come to our mind, because it's so easy to follow the models we've seen and the instructions we carry within. But what is their psyche saying there? And I then try to ask the question, all right, and are your behaviors, your values, your consequences rising out of the best places within you? one of the questions I've always suggested to people is, it doesn't matter what you think, feel, or believe perhaps that much. What does matter, and profoundly so, is what is that in service to inside of you? Is that a received authority? Something that you've observed from people or you felt was your marching orders for your life? Or is it something you've truly come to in your own journey in a way that has helped you live a fulfilling life? And what is it that you find is so contradictory? What about those stuck places within your life? Why are they stuck? What are the fears that are blocking you and keeping you stuck? In doing workshops around the country and other continents, I've often asked people the question, and if it's in a workshop where people are writing and responses and so forth, where are you stuck? And no one has ever said, well, what do you mean stuck? Even in foreign languages where we had to have that translated, what do you mean stuck? And the question then is, if I can so readily identify where I'm stuck, well, why can't I get unstuck? Or what about our addictive patterns? We begin to realize that addictive patterns are far more common than we think. It's not so much just about dangerous substances. We all have addictive patterns if you understand that addictive patterns are reflexive. That is to say, they just stimulus response, they happen, they take over, they have a life of their own. That addictive patterns are anxiety management systems that are reflexive in character. They're seldom chosen, they're reflexive, which is why they get so hard to break, so hard to change. And they will show up in various ways. One of the addictive patterns we all have, myself included, and you wouldn't think about this as an addiction, is simply habit. Notice how if the paper is not there as you expected in the morning, or the traffic's heavier and you're going to be late for an appointment, notice the amount of energy that's generated. And then you realize, okay, it's not even about what it seems to be about. It's about, you know, my experience of losing control. It's my experience of the essential chaos of life and so forth. One of the points I make there in that book about depth psychology is the principle that I always operate with is it's not about what it's about. If it was about what whatever it was about, then we could sort of solve it. We could deal with it. That's what ego consciousness helps us deal with. How do I open this jar of tuna? How do I, you know, solve this problem? Our ego works pretty well to interface with the world. But when it comes to dialoguing with the inner life, then we realize, okay, I'm not so adept here. And seldom is it about what it's about. What we try to do is begin to explore what this is in service to inside of a person. Now, again, I'm not saying everybody should be in therapy. That's not my point. I'm simply saying a therapeutic attitude is essential to paying attention to your own soul, because the price otherwise is self-estrangement. We become strangers to ourselves. That literally, in the end, our psyche wants our growth and development and our healing. And our growth and development may not be easy or comfortable for us because it might in fact call us to take some risks in life. Nature is not necessarily interested in our comfort, as you may have noticed. And sometimes growing up, which means I've really become accountable for what is wanting to be expressed in the world through me, will not make my life easy or comfortable. Most of the people you have revered in history didn't have convenient lives, didn't have comfortable lives. Many of them suffered. Here in Washington, we just lost John Lewis this week. A man of enormous conviction and contribution to our society, but also a man of enormous suffering as well. But what we admire is somehow someone holding to that which is true for them. And when you see that, you realize it's not about being happy. That's a kind of silly preoccupation that we have. Nothing wrong with being happy, but happiness is not a steady state. Happiness is a transient experience that occurs to us when we're in right relationship to our own souls. And we can have all the wealth of the world, we can have all the privileges of the world, because you know people who virtually have that, and you have to say, well, how happy are their lives? Happiness is a secondary phenomenon. The primary phenomenon always is meaning, again. If what I'm doing with my life is meaningful to me, then I will be flushed with happiness. In my work, I will spend hour by hour, day after day, being present to people suffering. That does not make me happy, but I'm happy in my work, if you get the distinction, because I can't imagine anything more meaningful and more honorific than the privilege of sharing someone else's life journey. So when we think about, I mean, I know people who are depressed because they're not happy, and they think they should be happy. And I think that often that's a kind of sort of cultural illusion or delusion, I should say, that is you know, very deleterious to all of us. It's more about, is your life meaningful to you? And how do you know? Is that confirmed from inside of you? Is it in some way giving you a sense of direction and purpose? And when you find that, that's how you find that inner resilience and that direction through difficult times. In 1862, in the height of the Civil War, Emily Dickinson, there in New England, wrote, "The sailor cannot see the north, but knows the needle can." And I think what she was suggesting in that axiom or precept was that one needs to have a compass. And in traditional eras, that compass came from the tribe, tribal authorities, sacred institutions, sacred scriptures. For increasing numbers of people, that authority has waned, not for all, but for many. And that authority or responsibility for that authority has shifted from the tribe to the shoulders of the individual. That's what makes us modern. And to be a modern is to be accountable. I can't expect some institution or some other person to fulfill my life. That's my role. That's my calling. And so I think what she was suggesting in a time of declining authority that she was already aware of back in 1862 is you better find your own compass. And when you do, you will find your capacity to chart your way through the thicket of choices that face you. And you will find when you're tracking in a direction that is right for you, not as defined by others, but right for you, then something inside supports you. And I'll conclude with these remarks and then turn it over to our questions. But I want to just add one piece here. Jung said once, we all need to find what supports us when nothing supports us. I think that's a profound statement. A lot of people have felt really prized out of the structures, relationships, patterns, expectations that seemingly supported them. So the question then is, what supports you when nothing supports you? And when you find that there is something inside of you that rises to support you and carry you through difficult times, that inner resilience, then you know that in some way you have developed a relationship, a deepened relationship, and frankly, a far more interesting conversation around the meaning of your own journey. And in a culture of profound distraction, as I said, rather few people ever really reach that point. But that means they're living someone else's life, someone else's authority. So part of what we all have to ask is, am I living the life that is meant for me, not by external parameters, but rather from the confirmations that come from within me? When I'm tracking in the best way for me, the support inside, the purposefulness, the energy is there, and it allows us to get through the most difficult of times. So Elizabeth, let's see what questions or comments have occurred to those in the audience today.
Sure. So I'm going to take this moment to remind people that we do have copies of the book available at Gibson's Bookstore, and I will drop a link to our sidebar. I do have a first question here from Doreen, who asks, if fear and lethargy are the enemies of living, can we overcome those obstacles and have what we don't even know what we really want?
It's an excellent question. She's obviously read other of my books. Because I mentioned in some of the earlier books that no matter what we do today, tomorrow morning, you can count on the fact that there'll be visitors in your bedroom. And if you don't just get up and rush away to wherever you're going, but you pay attention and you look at the two gremlins standing at the foot of the bed, you'll see they're there. They're stationed there. They're pretty permanent. One is fear, who says to you, whispers in your ear, it's just too much for you. It's too big for you. You can't handle that. You're not going to be able to take it all on. Better figure out some way to slip slide away. Lethargy says, chill out. Turn on the telly, watch Oprah, have some chocolate. Tomorrow's another day. And they're the enemies of life. 1912, Jung wrote a book called Symbols of Transformation, in which he said, the spirit of evil, strong language, spirit of evil is negation of the life force by fear. And if the risk is not taken, the meaning of life is violated, and we live in a drab gray. He also said in that same book, he said, every morning we awaken desiring to drown in our own lethargy and to fall back into the sleep of childhood, to stay unconscious, to avoid accountability. And that's in all of us. And to some degree, we have to conquer that to get into life on even the most daily of basis. But what is most important is to ask those places where you are most blocked, most stuck, and realize that there are spectral presences there that stand there with large scimitars or swords blocking you, and there are fears. And most of those fears are not going to happen. They are, you know, profound in our history, but they're not present to the adult that you've become. And if they were to happen, you would find that you can take it on. You have the adult resources, that the wherewithal to live this journey. Because, you know, we come equipped, that's the point. You might admire your ancestors and say, how did they get through such difficult times? We live such privileged lives. Well, the truth is, they had to draw upon resources within. They didn't have modern medicine. They didn't have the modern inventions that give us so many conveniences. They had to draw from within. And they learned, most of them learned, that there was a responsive center there that supported them. So how do we get through? Well, you show up every day. In one of the books, I don't remember if it's this one or not, I say my personal motto is very simple, 6 words, shut up, suit up, show up. Shut up. And I say these things to myself every morning. Nobody has to listen, but I do. Shut up means don't complain, no whining. Your life is privileged, all things considered. You have your problems, but they're nothing compared to some people who have no food today. Their children are being killed. They have no roof over their head. You don't have any problems, just shut up. Suit up. Do your homework. Prepare. Take it on. Do what you need to do to take on your life. And thirdly, show up. Just do the best you can. Perfectionism is a stupid idea. It's never achieved. And we all have memories of imperfection and memories of failure and so forth, and they haunt us. You just do the best you can. And in doing that, you're serving the world around you. Again, this is not about narcissism or self-absorption. It's about bringing your best self to your relationships, to your children, and to the world in which you find yourself. So it's a fight, to answer the question. It's a big fight, but it's a good fight. And it's a fight that some days you can actually win.
I'm reminded a little bit of the quote that perfection is the enemy of progress, which is also perfection is the enemy of good. And that sounds very similar. If you try to have it be perfect, then you're never going to take those first steps.
That's right.
We have a question here from Janine who says, I try to be a positive person, but with all that is going on around us, I'm having a hard time. I don't watch the news as often and I dip into the chocolate too often. I do. Any suggestions so I'm not so sullen?
Well, interestingly enough, the word sullen was an ancient word that actually meant a very private or individual person. So it has another meaning. Excuse me, beside the one I think you're meaning here. Look, I'm sorry. This is a difficult time. To feel depression is natural because depression is something pushed down. What's been pushed down? Your normal freedoms, your normal life. Some depression is normal and natural. It's the kind of depression that comes from an outer loss or an outer encounter with reality, which oppresses your life. That's not pathological. The depression we most often talk about is that where our own psyche doesn't cooperate. We'll just say I'm putting all my energies in a certain direction and I find there's just no sense of satisfaction, or I've been doing it over and over, and even though I value what I was doing, the energy is not there again. Well, that's the psyche's autonomous withdrawal of approval and its support from where the ego and its influencers up here have been trying to invest things. And that's the kind of depression that often brings people into therapy. And what it's asking is you know, a change in their lives and their journeys and their values. But, the chocolate is probably not going to kill you. It's a trade-off. And you have to realize during this time, I am invited, and you can't do it 24 hours a day. I'm invited to a conversation. And one of the ways to do it, frankly, is books. As I began, you know, a book is a report on the mystery of things. And there are so many reports out there. I won't live long enough to read all the books I want to read, but I can assure you I'm keeping reading them as I go along. And I think it's important to realize that part of this involves such things as journaling, writing your own memory, seeing what comes up. When you wake in the morning, don't just jump up and go somewhere. It's, what was I thinking? What was I seeing? What was there? And we realize we've been dreaming. Write it down. Develop those associations. Why is it that my dream maker brought my third grade teacher and a television character and someone from my contemporary life, all in the same dream? It's crazy. It's so crazy, I don't even want to pay attention. No, the dream maker is a scavenger, and it uses and pulls together these different disparate elements to weave into a kind of unfolding internal mythological system, the attendance upon which gives you this sense of again, a sustaining conversation. Remember that sentence from Jung. What supports us when nothing supports us? And finding that is the critical turn in our entire lives. When we find that, we realize we're not alone when we're alone. We're present to something here. We're present to goodly company. We're present to an ongoing conversation. This in no way diminishes our friendships and our other associations. It's simply saying this makes them all the richer.
So we do have a question. What is the first step for someone who wants to become more comfortable with their own quiet and their own self? What is the first thing that they should do to begin to unpack all of their learned distractions?
Well, remember Pascal saying in the 17th century, our biggest problem was the difficulty of sitting with ourselves in a private room? And you might actually try that. I'm not saying this is a lifestyle. I'm saying this is an invitation to at least walk into the vestibule of a deepened conversation. Notice how you're uncomfortable and ask yourself why. What is so disquieting to me? Notice the traffic going on inside. You can't help that. It's just a lot of traffic. It's busier than O'Hare Airport at rush hour inside of each of us. Just don't stay attached to it. It's what the Buddhists and others call the monkey mind. You know, it jumps about and chatters constantly. Our life is full of that chatter. and all of it's distracting in some way, is constant noise. Focus on a single image. Focus on a single thought. And yes, your mind will stray, and just try to bring it back on. It's like starting bringing an airplane back on a radio direction beam that's allowing it to take its choice. And you will find this is not easy. The simplest of things is not easy. But when you find that, you do it again and again, and it gets a little bit easier. Now, this is not about further isolation. What this is about is trying to make some kind of different rapprochement with yourself. Because again, I want to repeat, that's the person we bring to others. Jung said once, the greatest burden a child must bear is the unlived life of the parent. So if I continue to grow and develop, that's clearing out space for my children and children's children. And it's also true, as I work on myself, that lifts some stuff off of my partner, my wife. Because one of the paradoxes of deaf psychology is we begin to realize our relationship with other people can never be any better than our relationship to ourselves. That's why this is not selfish or self-indulgent. It's actually improving our contribution to the world. It's a gift, ultimately. So I would say, start practicing with this terrible, terrible thing, is being just present to yourself and allowing yourself to be wholly there. And when you see the difficulty, ask yourself, what is so difficult? Why should I be afraid of my own self? What is in there that I feel is so harmful to me? Because nature is not against us. We have all kinds of other little complexes in us, that's for sure. That's where the noise comes from, plus the outer world. But what is so difficult about being able to be with ourselves? And if you can move against that a little bit, I think you will begin to find over time, because this, you have to practice this, becomes a kind of discipline, a practice. You'll find you're operating out of a different place in your life. I've seen clients, for example, who come in completely scattered, unraveled, and understandably, and you begin to see things beginning to coalesce. And that's sort of the movement of the authority from out there to inside of them. Because the biggest project of the second half of life is the recovery of the personal authority. You have it when you're an infant, it's called instinct, but we're not able to enact that in the world of giants around us in our vulnerability and dependency. So the trade-offs have to occur. But personal authority is what is true for me from all of that traffic. And now can I live that with courage and consistency in the world? And if I do, but my life changes in a profound way. This is not magic. This is hard work. It's not new agey stuff. This is hard work. It's humbling. But the payoff is a much, much richer life, as I suggested.
So we are with Dr. James Hollis, whose new book, Living Between Worlds, Finding Personal Resilience in Changing Times, is his new work. If you have questions that you would like him to answer, please feel free to drop them into the chat and into the Q&A box. Do you find, Dr. Hollis, that the current culture of distraction is making this more and more prevalent?
Well, it's certainly increasing the din of the noise outside of us, absolutely. That's one reason I think, and I'm not saying this because I'm talking to a bookstore audience, I think books saved my life. I grew up in a working class family in the Midwest that my father was pulled out of grade school and sent to work before child labor laws. My mother worked as a secretary. They had harsh and demanding lives. And their advice to me, which was very well intended, was, you know, don't go out there. It's too big. We'll stay here and we'll take care of each other. You know, sort of circle the wagons. And I understand where that came from. I think it would have killed my soul. And so my heroes were my teachers and the local librarian, who Esther Hunt, I name her by name, who opened the, she said to me after a while, she says, you don't have to stay in the childhood section anymore. You can go read any book here you want. I think my parents were a little upset by that, but it was the beginning of my leaving home, actually, I suppose. They should have been upset. But for me, books opened these worlds. They weren't escape, although sometimes escape is not a bad thing. They were always telling me there are new things to learn, places to see, people to meet, ideas to wrestle with. Similarly, when I was young, I thought, as many young people do, well, if I work hard enough, read enough books, talk to the right people, I'll sort of figure out what life is about. And I can remember with great enthusiasm, I took my first philosophy class in college, and I thought, well, this is, you know, the great philosopher is going to tell you what it's all about, right? Well, within a few weeks, I was confused because all they were doing was producing more and more questions. And slowly began to realize, well, okay, it's your questions that get you your life, not your certainties. It's the questions that open the doors. It's questions that get you on your journey. And today I think I would say it's not where we arrive, it's the journey that gives us the sense of purpose and meaning in our lives. What kind of journey are you on? And one of the wonderful places we have as a resource are the books available to us, whether they're in history or psychology or whatever it is that appeals to you and summons something from you in response is an open door for you. So it's again, a report on the mysteries of this world, and what is that report doing to enlarge your life?
Is there any advice that you would give young James Hollis now?
Yes, sure. Because with all due love and respect, my parents' lives were governed by fear, and a lot of it was economic fear. A lot of it was just fear of how difficult life was. I think I would have said to that child, and I've actually thought about that, I think I would take a long walk and put my arm around his shoulders and say, you know, it's going to be okay. There's something in you that knows, you know, people around you mean well, but they're talking about their lives, and you're just going to be different. And it's okay that it's different, because the thought maybe of leaving them at that time would have been untenable. But you know, you're going to do some travels here, and it's going to be okay. I think just simple reassurance. As a matter of fact, that's probably good for almost any child to hear, because that gives them a certain permission to have the questions that they have, and really, really maybe value the challenges that matter to them. Because so often we learn early, life is conditional, and you'll be accepted by others if you meet those conditions. Well, that's how we start losing ourselves, as a matter of fact. And I know we don't live in isolation, so we have to deal with the world as it is. But giving that child the sense that what is wanting expression in you is going to be your surest guide to an interesting life. It's going to take you to places, and I don't mean just geographies, but places of insight and experience you don't even know exist, but which will prove in the long run something that provides so much quality and depth to your life. And just go with it. It's going to be okay. And you will find that you have the inner resources to get you through all that.
Well, Dr. Hollis, thank you for joining us this evening and sharing your wisdom with us. Gibson's Bookstore does have Living Between Worlds available to mail out to anybody ordering online. We also have signed book plates coming, which we will include with any purchase from Gibson's Bookstore. Dr. Hollis, any words of wisdom to take us out of this event?
Well, thank you for your invitation to join you this evening. I thank all those who have been present. I would simply say, as I would say to that child that you just asked, you have an interesting life, and a lot of it's yet to be discovered. And this book and others I've written are all invitations to risk that, to take that seriously in a new way, again, not out of any self-indulgence, but out of a sense of integrity. Because, you know, that's what leads you to an authentic journey, not one that's been defined by those around you, however well-intended they might have been. The bottom line question is, what wants to enter the world through you? And am I living my life in accordance with that? And if I can address those questions, you will find a deepened sense of purpose and something inside that rises to support you through that.
Thank you so much for joining us this evening. Thank you, everybody, joining us at home from all of us at Gibson's Bookstore. Have a great night, everybody.